As already explained in the introduction to my talk, so in my group, we mostly use molecular dynamic simulations, and the topic of my of our work is mainly understanding protein aggregation processes which lead to diseases, and these are most of the time the neurodegenerative diseases, and in particular, we are interested in Alzheimer's disease. Yeah, and Alzheimer's disease, there are like mainly two proteins or peptides involved which do aggregate, and we are concerned with the so-called amyloid beta peptide. The other one is the tau protein. The amyloid beta peptide, it's being produced in all of us throughout our whole lifetime. It's produced from the amyloid precursor protein, which is transmembrane protein, which sits in the membranes of the neuronal cells. And by the actions of two secretases, the amyloid beta peptide is being cut, and it's then released into the extracellular space. And either depending on mutations in the peptides or due to aging processes, either more and more of these peptides is being produced, or the clearing mechanisms don't properly work anymore, or the peptide due to mutations has become more aggregation prone. For either of these reasons, the peptide starts to aggregate, and then it first forms oligomers. And some of these oligomers can continue to grow in large aggregates, which are then the amyloid fibrils. And the amyloid fibrils can clump together and then form these amyloid plaques, which were already seen more than 100 years ago by Alois Alzheimer. For a couple of years, until around 2000 to 2010, the focus really has been on the plaques and the fibrils. But then people realized that the fibrils are not that toxic. It's more the oligomers which are toxic. And the oligomers are quite small, ranging from dimers to around dodecamers. And that's why the fibrils are still important, because they are the defined endpoint with a nice structure. But nonetheless, if one really wants to target the disease progression, one needs to target the oligomers. And in my group, we use molecular simulations, in particular molecular dynamic simulations, in order with the aim to understand the oligomer formation of the amyloid beta peptide. Here's again another summary of this aggregation process. And quite often, these peptides or proteins which do aggregate and form to neurodegenerative diseases are also called intrinsically proteins, intrinsically disordered proteins, or sometimes only intrinsically disordered protein regions. So these are IDPs or IDPRs. For instance, the amyloid beta peptide, it's never really folded. That's why here in this scheme here going from NA, panel A from left to right, this one does not really apply for A beta, because A beta is never folded. So we don't have like the going from the folded to the misfolded protein, because it's an IDP which is unfolded all the time. Other of these proteins, like alpha synuclein, which is connected to Parkinson's disease and other diseases, it's also pretty much unfolded, even though it has some folded regions. And then, for instance, the prion protein is pretty much folded, apart from the first 90 residues, which are unfolded. And this completely unfolds and then forms, adopts a completely different structure, which is then the fibrillar structure. So what I want to say is that these peptides and proteins, they can be quite different, but what they have in common, that they can first form oligomers, and in most cases, these oligomers are the toxic species, and then they continue to grow, to form fibrils and larger aggregates. The formation of these aggregates here, so they are defined by a nice beta sheet structure, which runs perpendicular to the fibril axis, can be monitored by, for instance, the thioflavin T fluorescence assay, because the thioflavin T binds to these fibrils, and thereby the fluorescence of this thioflavin T is being enhanced. And another, so that's like what one would also call the solid phase of a protein. But these proteins, especially the IDPs, can undergo a liquid phase separation, and that would be the liquid phase of the protein. And out of the liquid phase of the protein, amyloid can also grow. So these are different pathways, and the people who work in the IDP field, they're very much concerned on the liquid-liquid phase separation. However, with the simulations that we perform in my group, we cannot really simulate the liquid-liquid phase separation. We focus on the formation of these oligomers. Let's have a look at the sequence of A beta. It's a short peptide. It has either 40 or 42 residues. The peptide with 42 residues is more toxic. This is like the one letter code, and the charged residues are colored. Positively charged residues are shown in blue, negatively charged ones in red. And what one can see is that A-beta is really divided. Of course, yeah, one always has an N-terminal half and a C-terminal half, but the N-terminal half of A-beta is very much charged. So and IDPs, for instance, they're characterized by a high amount of charged residues, and so the N-terminal half agrees to the finding, like, okay, that should be an IDP because it has 43% of charged residues, which according to this plot here is sufficient to be considered to be an IDP. And then we have the C-terminal third, but also some other residues here, like in the middle of the peptide, which are very hydrophobic. So and basically what I always see, A-beta is like a chameleon because we have this N-terminal disordered part and we have the C-terminal half, which is pretty hydrophobic and which has a high tendency to become folded. And this is really makes the characteristics of this peptide. So this fight between the N-terminal half, which wants to be unfolded, and the C-terminal half, which wants to be folded. And when we do the simulations, we can see this. So here you can see the molecular dynamics simulation of A-beta in water. So the water is not seen, but it was an MD simulation, which was performed for 5 microseconds in explicit water. And of course, we also had sodium chloride at a physiological concentration of 150 millimolar in simulation. We perform molecular dynamics simulations. We use the software COMEX for this. With the force field, this is which force field to use. It's a tricky question. So we use all atom force fields, and the simulations of IDPs is a bit more difficult than the simulations of folded proteins, because for the folded proteins, one has a well-defined target. That's why it's easier. I don't want to say it's easy, but it's easier to derive good parameters for folded proteins, whereas for IDPs, which are most of the time disordered in a random coil state, quite extended. But IDPs are characterized that they can become folded up in interactions with binding partner. And this has to be inscribed in the force field parameters too. And therefore, it's not that easy to make a good force field choice. So we, after many, many force field benchmarks and reading a lot of papers, we came to the conclusion that at the moment, CHARMM36M is the best force field for amyloid beta, because we not only want to simulate the monomeric state, but we also want to simulate its aggregation, which is also not that easy. Okay, here you see Newton's second equation, which is being solved and running an MD simulation. But of course, we use software, which is developed by others. And in this case, it's COMEX. Okay, so we run simulations. It means we produce a lot of data. And while looking at movies like here, it is fun. It is also important because one needs to get an initial impression of what is happening in the trajectory. One, of course, has to do a proper analysis. And for this, we quite often use so-called transition networks, for which we developed our own software for this analysis. And it means, so we have our molecule, or we have more than one molecule, and we need a molecular descriptors or features, whatever you want to call it, which define different states of the peptide or protein. For instance, here for the amyloid beta peptide, we thought, okay, the distance between the N-terminus and the C-terminus might be a useful. Yeah, you can see here, sometimes there's some beta sheet formation, so we want to keep track how much beta sheet formation takes place. And in principle, it could also happen that some alpha helices are being formed, so we also count the number of residues which are in an alpha helical state. And from the MD simulations, we of course have the knowledge about the transition between the states. So meaning we have like now we have these three descriptors, end-to-end distance, number of residues in the beta sheet formation, and number of residues in the alpha helix conformation. And based on these three descriptors, we can each snapshot that we sampled during our MD simulation, we can assign three numbers, and snapshots which have the same numbers, they define the same state. And if some structures are more sampled than the others, then the plots or the circles you can see here become larger because the population of the states is larger. And the other states, which are rarely sampled, they have like the small dots seen here. And the lines between these dots, this is the information about the dynamics, because we know which state makes transitions to the other states. And then one can also see, okay, between some states we have many transitions, and some other states there are only few transitions, and sometimes they are also like dead ends, as you can see here. You go there once and then you come back and sample other states. Here in the circles here on the top and on the bottom, I've shown some characteristic snapshots or conformations which agree to these states, which are defined by the different colors. For instance, here with a small end-to-end distance between the N-terminus and the C-terminus, they are quite close to each other, and a lot of beta sheet, as you can see, it's seen here. These are collected here in these red circles. And on the other hand here, with the gray circles, we have the snapshots with a large end-to-end distance, and neither beta sheet nor alpha helix. And yeah, so with this, we can get an impression of the conformational landscape of the peptide, and we could even calculate the free energy of it, so that we can sort the snapshots based on the free energy, and even we can even calculate the transition energies for going from one state to the other, or from the statistics that we collect during our MD simulations. Okay, but as I said initially, while understanding the monomeric form of A-beta is important, we also want to know about the aggregation. And today I will limit it to the dimerization, though we also simulate the formation of tetramers and hexamers, but not larger than hexamers, because these simulations are quite time consuming. And at the moment, we think the hexamers are sufficient. Okay, I show you the results for the A-beta dimers. We sampled a lot. We first performed 40 microseconds of standard MD simulations. Then we saw one transition, which was sampled only once. And we tried several times to get more statistics on this single transition, and we did not succeed. And then we decided, okay, let's switch to enhanced sampling. And in this case, we decided to go for replica exchange molecular dynamics simulation. So it means we run 64 replicas in parallel, each replica for 1 microsecond. Then if you know a bit about replica exchange, there's the possibility to exchange either the temperatures of the simulations, or you exchange the conformations. It doesn't matter what you exchange, the result will be the same. And only if you make these exchanges, you have a benefit, because at a high temperatures, you can the system crosses energy barriers, so it can reach new phases of the or new spaces of the phase space, and then the temperature goes down again, and then it reaches the minimum after doing some transitions. Here we don't calculate transition networks, as I just showed, but we use calculate so-called Markov state models for this. We use software which is developed in a group by Frank Noy at the Freie University in Berlin. And so it means we have to at the initial step is a dimension reduction. So we use the C-alpha distances, so the distances between the C-alpha atoms within the peptides and between the peptides. This gives us almost 1,800 dimensions. And of course, we don't, as a human, we don't really want to look at almost 2,000 dimensions because we cannot make sense of this anymore. And so we apply time lag independent component analysis to identify the slowest motions of the system. And henceforth, we only look at two coordinates, meaning for the two slowest motions along the x-axis and the y-axis. So that here you see the sample density in this along these two slowest motions. And then we already show here some structures. And the first thing we can see is that we have rather extended structures and we have compact structures. And the transitions between the compact and extended structures, either along this coordinate or along this coordinate, these are the slowest processes. We also calculated then the compactness to characterize them more quantitatively, so the compactness, and we also calculated the amount of beta sheet formation to characterize the secondary structure. Then with a Markov state model, like with the transition networks, one can identify states. In this case, we identify the kinetically stable states. And we found a nice Markov state model with 8 states, which are here shown with these circles. And the lines, again, are the transitions between them. For each state, we show some characteristic structures. For instance, state 6 and 8, these are the more compact states. And state S1, that's the most extended state. To characterize these dimers in more detail, we can calculate the contacts between the residues within the peptide and between the residues of the two peptides forming the dimers. So these the intrapeptide contacts are seen here. Along the diagonal, you have many contacts, which is clear because residue I is in contact with residue I plus 1 and I plus 2 and so on. So that the diagonal here is not so important. It's more like the orthogonal diagonal or anti-diagonal because this is typical the signature of an antiparallel beta sheet. So this here, what you see here and here, these are antiparallel beta sheets, which also are confirmed when you look at the structures. We have here the beta hairpin structure, which gives rise to an antiparallel beta sheet. And these antiparallel beta sheets can either come together forming interpeptide parallel beta sheets. This is this line, or we can also form antiparallel interpeptide beta sheets. Here on the other side, these are the intrapeptide contacts for the extended dimers. We have again a very nice antiparallel beta sheet and only one, as you can see here. And again, they can form from a parallel and antiparallel interpeptide beta sheets. Okay, the nice thing with Markov state modeling is that we can also extract the mean first passage time for the transitions between the states. And this confirms that the transitions to the compact states here and here, these are the slowest transitions with transition times of around 100 microseconds or 50 microseconds. And once these states are reached, then there's a high tendency to immediately go back to states S5 or S7. Okay, this was the aggregation in vitro. But if you really want to understand what's going on in the brain, one really needs to think, okay, what else is there in the brain? So, and I just said, or in the beginning, I said that the amyloid beta peptide is an extracellular peptide. And so if one has a look at the extracellular space, one realizes that the space is not empty between the neurons and the astrocytes, but it's filled with the extracellular matrix. And the extracellular matrix is different depending where you are. Close to the neurons, you have the perineuronal nets. Then close to the blood vessels, one has the basal membrane, and then in between you have the interstitial fluid, which also has like different components, different molecules, especially either collagen when it's close to the blood vessels, or it's hyaluronan when it's close to the neurons. You have glycosaminoglycans, which can attach to proteins. Then you have proteoglycans, you have ions, you have other osmolytes. You can have oxidative stress. You can have changes in pH due to the formation of compartments, or due to inflammation. You can have, or there are chaperones inside the cells. There are chaperones, but also in the extracellular space, there are chaperones. So the extracellular chaperones are mostly different from the chaperones which are found in the cells. Within the cells, you have crowding due to the presence of a huge amount of other proteins. And I also just mentioned the extracellular matrix. So it means if one really wants to get an understanding of what is going on in the brain when amyloid beta aggregation happens, one should make an attempt to include these different conditions. Not only when we do the simulations, but also, of course, for the people who do the experiments. And I started to do quite early on simulations where I included different aspects of the extracellular spaces, for like the addition of particular ions. In this case, it was copper ions, because amyloid beta is a peptide which binds very nicely to copper, because it has three histidine residues which are close to each other. We included the aspects of oxidative stress, and we looked what happens to the peptide when we change the pH, with considering small pH changes as found in inflammation. And quite recently, we moved on to lipid membranes. And now I want to give you a brief overview of about our recent study, where we simulated or mimicked a neuronal membrane. So we set up a membrane model, the 400 lipids in total, where we included PUPC, PUPE, and PUPS, in addition to cholesterol, sphingomyelin, and the ganglioside GM1. So the PhD student, she's now postdoc in my group, Hiba Fadafta, she first did an intense literature search to find really the average composition of these neuronal membranes. As a simplification, we modeled the symmetric membrane. Of course, in our future work, we should consider that, of course, the neuronal membrane, as most of the biological membranes, is not symmetric, but the extracellular leaflet is different than the intracellular leaflet. This was like a starting point. We added two peptides on top of the membrane, quite far away. So initially there was no contact between membrane and peptides. And then we added simulations for 12 microseconds. And for comparison, we used the simulation. I just showed you the first 12 microseconds of the dimer simulations in solution. What we immediately say is, so the GM1, which is shown in yellow, this lipid has a certain number of sugar groups attached to the head group, or it is it a head group, and this sticks out, as you can see here. This is a bit above or below the surface of the membrane. These sugar groups have a high tendency to form hydrogen bonds with the other sugar groups of a neighboring ganglioside. That's why we see a lot of clustering of GM1, even though there's only 4% of the membrane composition is like GM1. And because these sugar groups with these hydroxy groups stick out, they really recruit A-beta to the membrane. So and A-beta has a high tendency to interact with the sugar groups of the ganglioside. So this is really the preferred interaction partner. On the time scale of our simulations, so the 12 microsecond one, we did not see deep membrane insertion. It really remained here on the surface. We can, as I just said, okay, the preferred interaction partner is GM1. This is confirmed when we calculate the interaction energy between the sugar groups, or the lipids and the peptides. And then we can decompose this for each amino acids of amyloid beta. And one can see, okay, the N-terminal half of Abida, which has these many charged residues. These are the residues which drive the association of Abida with the membrane. And there, in particular, the residue arginine 5 is pretty much interacting with the membrane. And this is of interest because in mice, the residue 5 is not an arginine, but a glycine. There are only three residues different between mice Abida and human Abida, but mice, the wild type mice, don't get Alzheimer's. So, and it seems that the arginine 5 seems to be very important for the toxicity of the amyloid beta peptide. Okay, we characterized again the aggregation in terms of transition networks. As I said, we are free in the choice of the molecular descriptors to choose. Here in the dimerization process, we of course want to know, is it a monomer that's here or is it a dimer which are here? We want to know, is the aggregation driven by hydrophobic interactions, which we calculated, so the numbers grow from left to right. And we wanted to know how much beta sheet formation takes place, which goes from bottom to right. And as you can see here, we have some beta sheet formation, but the one peptide which prefers to interact a lot with the ganglicides, this is shown here in the bottom corner here. These are the intrapeptide contacts. We see, okay, there's not much beta sheet formation, and this is by further analysis, we confirmed the interactions of the Abida with the ganglioside destroys the beta sheet formation to a certain extent in the Abida peptide. This is quite interesting because, together with experimental results, one can now start to make start understanding what the effect of the GM1 is. For comparison, again, this the same kind of transition network for the simulations of Abida in solution, so without the neuronal membrane, and there we see like these nice beta sheets, this extended dimer, which I showed you initially already. Okay, this is again a summary of what I just said. Let's rather move on in vivo conditions. The extracellular matrix is very short, only one slide, which again shows the different components of the extracellular matrix, depending whether one is close to a neuron or close to a blood vessel or somewhere in between. And as I already said, we have like, when we stay close to the neuron, where we have the perineuronal nets, we have, for instance, hyaluronan, and we have proteoglycanes with different glycosaminoglycanes. And so we started to do two simulations of these, like, for instance, here with the chondroitin 4 sulfate, which has is quite negatively charged. So we have a pentamer of this dimeric unit, which has then a charge of 10 minus. Abida at neutral or at physiological pH has a charge of 3 minus. So quite often we have electrostatic repulsion, as you can see here. So that Abida and this little glycosaminoglycane don't even interact with each other. But of course, the positively charged residue of Abida sometimes lead to interactions between the peptide and the GAG. And this is sufficient cause some structural changes in the Abida. So at least I find this very fascinating that such transient interactions can have a huge impact on the whole behavior of the peptide. So that's something where we were just at the start of our research, and more will follow in the coming months and years, I hope. Okay, these are conclusions for Abida. As I just said, Abida has IDP-like properties, and it's like chameleon because it has a hydrophilic N-terminal half and a very hydrophobic C-terminal third. And this hydrophobicity is usually not sufficient to cause folding in Abida, but as soon as you give Abida an interaction partner, which can be a hydrophobic scaffold, like the tails of lipids, which I didn't show here, or like a charged surface, like, for instance, glycosaminoglycan, then Abeta can become folded, and Abeta can also become folded up in self-association, which when we see the beta sheet formation during the aggregation of Abeta. And then especially the hydrophobic residues in the C-terminus are important, but also there are some other hydrophobic residues in the middle of the protein, which are a peptide, which are very important as well. And something which is very interesting, so there are a couple of disease mutations which lead to an early onset Alzheimer's disease, like the Arctic mutation where residue 22 is replaced from a glutamate to a glycine, or the Dutch mutation where the same residue is mutated to a glutamine, or the D23N mutation. And these mutations make Abeta less charged, and they make it less like an intrinsically disordered protein. And that's also something which I find very fascinating, so that the less IDP like it is, the more aggregation prone it is. Okay, in my abstract I promised that I would also talk about drug discovery approaches. I have to speed up a bit, but I realized when looking at the clock. So for the drug discovery approaches, I only want to briefly mention a project that I do in cooperation with Professor Erdem. Erdem, now I don't see his last name. So Erdem for short, and my former postdoc, Badouane Kaf. And we use the knowledge that we gain from our simulations and the guidance of drug discovery approaches, but not for Alzheimer's disease in this case, but for the approaches, for instance, for the alpha-synuclein, which is involved in Parkinson's disease, but also in multiple system atrophy. And because we see that like certain features or like structural elements like certain beta sheets form very early on, even in the oligomers during the aggregation, and then also by the analysis of different fibrous structures, which were determined by cryo-EM extracted from the brains of people who died from multiple system atrophy. And one can see, for instance, that this loop and turn region here is always found in these structures. So what we did a docking approach where we first scanned 650 million compounds. We didn't dock 650 million compounds, but my postdoc Badouane, he analyzed them he used an artificial intelligence method, which was published to make a prediction how good the different compounds are able to penetrate the blood-brain barrier. And from the 650 million compounds, we then reduced it to 3 million compounds, which we all docked to this structure. We used Autodoc Vena, so the ones which is open source for the academic world. And we always do, after the docking, we always do full atomistic MD simulations to evaluate how stable the docking predictions are. And based on our predictions, Erdem then tests our predictions in the wet lab. Okay, but now I'll stick to drug discovery, but I switch the topic. I now, a topic you all know, I guess, it's the treatment for COVID-19. Like it's the SARS-CoV-2 virus. I think you all know that's the virus. It enters the host cell. It unloads its RNA, and then the RNA is translated into the viral proteins. Along that way, the replication complex of the virus is being formed, and that's where we try to intervene, as many others, using the main protease of the replication complex. Here you can see, so the main protease is a dimer. Here you can see one monomeric unit of the dimer with the active site here. Here's a close-up of the active site. We have a catalytic diet composed by histidine at position 41 and cysteine at position 145. So when we started the project about 2.5 years ago, so more or less directly after COVID-19 became a problem in February or March, 2020. And so we docked at that time, we docked more than 1.2 million molecules. We used the Sync database. We did ensemble docking. So we used the crystal structure, which was available at that time. So there was only one crystal structure at the time. Now there are multiple structures in the protein database of this main protease. Ensemble docking, then from the average over the ensemble docking, we selected 151, protein ligand complexes for MD simulations. Based on this, we selected 25 of an enzyme inhibition assay, and then we moved on to the antiviral cell assay. Since my time is more or less over, I don't go into detail now here, so because I prepared slides for each of them, only briefly one or two sentences per slide only. So for the docking of the 1.2 million molecules, existing drugs were included so in the sense of having our drug repurposing in mind, all FDA, all approved drugs, all investigational. We used the Sync database. It has about 150,000 natural products, which we used, and then we included about 1.1 million other compounds just to make sure that we didn't miss anything. And then we calculated, of course, the docking score in terms of binding free energy delta G, which is being spit out by Autodoc Wiener. And then we said, okay, we want to have something which is as close as possible to the catalytic diet, which we calculated. And then we selected here around 150 molecules, which we for which we continued MD simulations. We ran an initial 20 nanoseconds MD simulations. And if the ligand stayed in the active site, then we continue to 100 nanoseconds. Here you see correlation remained nicely bound. And here you see another one, conivaptan, which left the binding site more or less immediately. And of course, such a simulation was not continued to 100 nanoseconds. In addition to this distance analysis, we also calculated again specifically the distance to the catalytic diet, and we calculated using MMPBSA the delta G from the MD simulation, so that from the 150, we identified 34 best compounds based on MD simulations and selected 20 of them, which we then tested in the wet lab. The wet lab tests were done in our institute in Jülich. So of course it's not my institute, but the institute that belongs to the same institute to which my group also belongs, and this worked quite nicely. Okay, here I have two slides which explains the enzyme inhibition assay, but I leave this out. So basically, what we tested whether our predictions from docking and MD are indeed able to inhibit the enzyme. And the aim, so everything which is in dark blue, these are the compounds which performed quite well in the enzyme inhibition assay. Some did not perform so well. And what we saw is like that contacts with the catalytic diet are the that's the descriptors which helps the most to make a prediction whether the enzyme will be really inhibited or not. So because here we had a better inhibition than here with only one kind of contact. We have one disulfiram, was also belong to our top predictions. This is quite interesting. Here you can see just the chemical structures. Most of them are quite large, have many rings, especially aromatic rings, but also many hydroxy groups and NH groups, or just nitrogens being involved. And here an exception is the disulfiram, which is quite small. It's normally a drug that is used in the alcohol abstinence-oriented treatment. And I mentioned this, but in particular, because others in parallel had found that at the same time, or they were a bit quicker than we were, that it's quite good. And they even went on to antiviral tests in the cell. And there, it wasn't the best in their test, but it worked. And what is interesting, it's like for the disulfiram, there are like two clinical studies, which are ongoing, and they should be finished in 2023, with the question like, okay, how good disulfiram is really in the treatment of COVID-19, and some results are look already quite promising. We did, because others were already worked on disulfiram, we did not continue to work on disulfiram. So we selected the 10 best compounds from our enzyme inhibition assay and sent it to a collaboration partner in Braunschweig at the Helmholtz Center for Infection Research, Professor Mark Bronstrop. He did checked in SARS-CoV-2 infected cells whether the compounds work or not. It should look like this. So a compound that works should give a signal like the green one. So it means the cells become the cell viability is rescued, whereas like the untreated cells, like here in red, they are not as viable anymore or even die. Unfortunately, apart from testosterone, none of our compounds worked. So this was then the big disappointment where we stopped last year for the time being. The testosterone was surprising because men are known to have a higher on average to suffer more from COVID-19. But of course, yeah, it's like many aspects play a role here. Take home message from this. I haven't talked so much about it, but at least our experience is that the docking with AutoDock Vena is not so reliable and not reproducible, even if one does and so, perform and so on. So that's something we at the moment we think about how to improve on this. And the other thing is, I think it's very important to include wet lab assays very early on to rule out things that don't work. Now, we at the moment did not give up our work on this project altogether, especially not since I also got funding from the Volkswagen Stiftung for this. The one thing is, because my feeling is that the small organic molecules, many different people already work on it, so we shifted our attention to peptides in close collaboration with Dr. Raphael Eberle and Dr. Monica Coronado. And then I have a collaboration with people in Nigeria, especially my former postdoc, Olojide Olubi, who's now professor at in Ado-Ekiti in Nigeria. And he sent us some plant extracts from Nigeria, and there we got some very promising results for some of the extracts. So we also continue to work on these natural product extracts. And yeah, since I mentioned Nigeria, I thought I mentioned, okay, in 2.5 weeks, I will be in Nigeria too, because I'm a co-organizer of this Drug Discovery Africa 2022 conference, which will take place in Ado-Ekiti. So I organize it with Olojide, whom I just mentioned. And so, yeah, I thought I just mentioned it because it's fun and it's something big coming up in my life. And it's already there because I'm very heavily involved in the organization. And with this, I would like to thank my group. I mentioned collaboration partners along the way and also the people which did the different parts of the work when shown with portraits. But of course, all others of my group are equally important. Funding is very important. Without funding, this work would not be possible. Yeah, and thank you for your attention.